Okay, so day two, I actually got on the way pretty early in the morning, on my way to Laguna Beach, Panama City, and as you can see, I gave the Samsung 360. You can see the camera there on the left side. The camera angle still sucks, but I gave the 360 a go, and that was the first camera mount, the first tripod I used, and ended up breaking not long into the journey, and I had to buy another one. But I was pretty sore after the first day, you know, as normally the case when you ride 6 or 7 hours, you know, I think I rode about 8 or 9 hours actually, and I was pretty tired, yeah, pretty sore, just to the lower back and the top of the legs and your ass, of course. And but you know, my goal was to get out of Florida, and these roads. I mean, this is quite a nice little road. But the heat, you know, with all the gear on, the heat was really, you know, really got you, especially when you come to cities like this and you, you're stopping a lot. You can see the camera tripod up. It's actually a fantastic camera. I mean, you can see the stitch lines quite clearly on it. That's something that, you know, they've got a new pro version coming out. But it was actually one of my favorite cameras, because how you worked it is you could set it on from your phone if you want to do it, but if you can set it up beforehand, you just set it up to video or time lapse or photo, and there's another one called looping, and you just press the button on the top at the start, or you can press it on your phone. I was using manually, just pressing it and stopping it. The file sizes get pretty large because it is a 4K camera, so a minute to 2 minutes is the maximum you really want to run it for. You get longer than that, it takes a while, but the process is pretty simple. You shoot the videos, and then you download the videos to your phone, and then you can edit the video on your phone, and then you can upload it to Facebook, YouTube, or you know, you save it to your phone, which takes a little bit of time depending on the file size. And then once it's saved to your phone, you can then post the photos or videos to Facebook, YouTube directly, and all the encoding's done. So you don't have to do any further encoding. It's actually a fantastic video and a fantastic device. And I actually broke the one of the lenses just gave out on me. And I've sent that back to myself. I haven't received it yet from Buenos Aires, and I bought another one because I really loved it so much, and it has great footage. You're limited, like my MacBook Air, I couldn't view the 360 videos on it on YouTube or anywhere. They just wouldn't come out as 360, but on another laptop, you know, they were fine. So but yeah, and then once you do that, you upload it, as long as you've got good internet access, Wi-Fi access or whatever. You know, and the file size, about 1 minute, you're getting, at full res, you're looking at about 1 gigabyte for every minute. So it can get the file sizes can get pretty large, but the actual view from the front and the rear is fantastic. And the new pro version, hopefully they just improve upon this version and don't try to create anything ridiculous out of it, just make the improvements. I never used the desktop software because it's only for PC, and I had a Mac for the first, you know, until I got to Mexico where I ended up buying a PC. Yeah, but anyway, once you get some of the views here where you're getting across some of the bridges and you're getting the ocean, you get a little bit of a breeze. But for the most part, the first few days of my riding was a pretty boring affair, you know, you're getting pretty sore, and because I was doing such big distances the first few days, just to get out of the you know, get into some nice areas in the US, and plus the fact that I never planned to actually ride from Miami to LA, compounded the issue that I just wanted to get to LA. I made a few different decisions as I went, and I decided to go to a few different places. But the first two or three days, once I got to New Orleans, after New Orleans, there were some alternative highways, But before New Orleans, there was nothing. You couldn't really go anywhere else except for the main roads. In fact, I tried to go off the main road at one stage. It was really boring in Florida. And basically the road, the other alternative road, was right next to the main road, and it was just ridiculous, you know. So it wasn't much of a change. And as you go longer into a trip like this, you really want to get off the main freeways to actually get anything, to get to some exciting views. And, you know, when you go through Mexico and these places, you get off the main roads, you're not stopping at tolls every 15 minutes and paying toll roads. And even though the toll roads were very good for the most part, they were pretty boring, you know. So I just took my time and I was having plenty of breaks. You know, I planned originally to ride for 2 or 3 hours and then take a break. As you can see here, I'm just going to have a little bit of a break in the car park here. I was looking for a bit of shade but couldn't find it. But then once I got off, and sorry about the camera, I still didn't realise that the camera was pointing too low. And that took me until I actually got to New Orleans where I can actually look at the footage. I didn't realise it, and then I was able to, you can see me, oh, see, it already broken there. Crappy piece of, you know, cheap bit of shit. Until I got to New Orleans, I didn't have many choices, and I hadn't been able to see the footage, so I, you know, had to go up about 2 points up on the slider for the video. The first few days riding was pretty tough for me, and you can see I'm cleaning the lens. And that's another thing, that this KTM tank bag, I ended up buying a new one of the same version, and that's become a pain in the ass too. You know, $160, $170 for a tank bag that's not waterproof, and the zipper, because you've got a lot of the times you're riding and you've got to, you know, get a cloth out or, you know, clean your visor and stuff like that, and you'll find that they don't, you know, the zipper just goes on them, you know. It's just not good enough quality. So the next tank bag and mount I'm going to get is a different. I'm not going to use the KTM one. But for the most part, the whole trip, this bike, the KTM 1290 Super Adventure, was just fantastic. I just loved it. You know, I had the power when I needed it. And it was just a really comfortable bike to ride. I got the premium seats, which, you know, not much thought went into the premium seats from KTM, because beforehand with the standard seats on the 1290, you can control the heat from the console, from the settings. But with the premium seats, you've got buttons on the left and the right-hand side behind your ass, basically, and you have to press the button, and you don't really know what version it's in. So it's a pretty pathetic effort from KTM in that part. Even though I love my bike, you know, I'm not going to just wax lyrical about everything about it. Just some of the things that, obviously, the premium seats were an afterthought. Then we couldn't get it connected. I don't know how they couldn't do. Connected through the settings on the bars, you know. That was really annoying for me, especially once I got into the south of South America, where it got cold. You know, you press a button, is my seat getting hot or not? You couldn't work it out, you know. So that was a little bit painful with the premium seats, but they were really comfortable. I've got to say, I felt, you know, there was, you always get tired if you're sitting on a bike for long periods of time, but I always felt comfortable on it. You know, I never really had, a lot of people used to complain about their bums and all that. You know, after about a week of riding, my body started getting used to the big long trips and stuff like that. So it wasn't such an issue for me. Mail or whatever I'm doing. So basically, you can see here I'm using the second mount. That's a second round mount, which is a fantastic mount. They're expensive because there's not much competition for them. And those little rubber knobs on the side, you've got to super glue them on. or else you'll lose a truckload of them. I started with about 12 of them and I was out of them because you stop off and you take the phone off and then all of a sudden one just pops out and falls somewhere and you can't find it, or you just didn't even realise that it happened until you the next day you get on the bike and you realise there's one missing. And then I had a second one, which is a GDS technology or something, and it's all inbuilt. So the phone, the S7 actually sits inside it, and then it's got its own charging stuff. But what I worked out is one of the phones I was using I'd already got rid of it off the bike by the second day. It was, you know, I'd used it a few times, but the problem was that it wasn't charging fast enough. And I've got a fast charger, and I had a fast charging cigarette lighter, whatever you call that, the thing you put into the cigarette lighter. But the GDS mount with the Google Maps running and the Rever app, which is a fantastic app, and you can see on the website where the actual Rever map, and it's a motorcycle guide. So I had them both running on the S7, the Samsung Galaxy S7, and the one on the right there's the S7 Edge. I had it running. The problem was that it was draining the battery faster than this technology from RAM mounts that they pretend, I suppose, is technology. And they've got a patent pending and all this sort of crap, but it actually is crap, you know. So I actually got rid of that and sent it back to Miami. You know, so I wouldn't ever advise to buy that. Because I'd been running it for a while and I kept wondering, why is it just, you know, it'd go 99, 98, 97% and it would keep going down. It was going down slowly, but if you're doing like a 6 or 7, 8, 9 hour day, it was getting down to zero and then you'd lose everything that you needed. So I quickly got rid of that and then I just used the normal cable that went with the a little bit of off-roading. I used the normal cable that went with the Samsung and with the cigarette lighter charger. The fast charging cigarette lighter charging was 100% all the time. So those issues went away fairly quickly. However, the GDS mount, or whatever they call it from RAM mounts, is, you know, like it was a pretty expensive thing. And I thought, well, it's got good protection because you slip your phone inside it and the GDS mount sits on your bike and you just clip it into your bike. But pretty frustrating and pretty annoying, and I won't be ever buying one of those again. And they've got a patent pending. I don't know what they want to patent for it, because it was pretty useless. So the first few days was getting used to everything and working out what all the things I was using. And the things that I weren't using. I was using the Garmin Maps thing for a while, but it just took so long to program stuff in. And, you know, some people will spend the time doing it on their desktop and then port it to their device and then off they go. But it just became too much of a hassle. But I did use the Garmin 590. I did use that for gas. It was great for gas stations and restaurants and things like that, especially in the more populated areas. But you know, with Garmin, you've got to pay for maps for South America, and it doesn't include some countries. And you know, I don't know why Garmin just don't use Google Maps and overlay their data on top of that, and so you can update the Google Maps and get an Android Auto version of it. Because they make devices, and that's what they're really good at making. So stick to making great devices that can be used on multiple, you know, on bikes, cars, whatever, and stop trying to be to provide the software, you know, a big, massive software solution to it as well. Because there's so many places I went with the Garmin where the map just wasn't registering. Like, it was like I was 50 miles away from the nearest road, you know, even on main roads and stuff like that, which is weird. And the Google Maps was great for the long distances, but Google Maps fell over. It wasn't very good in the cities, any of the small cities, because it didn't know anything about one-way streets and stuff like that. In the major cities like Buenos Aires, Santiago, it was better, but some of the minor cities, you know, 20, 30, 50,000 people in a lot of the countries that it had the roads, but it didn't know which was one way and which was another. And it's pretty frustrating when you actually go to those towns and you know where you've got to get to, and the maps are telling you how to get to it, but there's all one-way roads going everywhere, you know. But for the most part, Google Maps I found that it was better than from the Garmin. Just once you get into Central and South America, once you get into the cities, you've got to just basically just view where you've got to get to on the mapping device, on your device, and then basically work your own way to get there. The camera I was using is the Drift Ghost S, and it's a great camera. The problem it has is you haven't got a lot of choices when it comes to cameras and microphones, and as you can hear, the microphone wasn't working at the time, even though I'm probably talking right now. So I basically ended up getting to Colombia, and I think I got three microphones shipped myself because Drift wouldn't ship it there, and I'll go on about that in a later series, in one of the later videos. But you basically, with the microphone, I bought a good quality Sony mic with it, didn't work. Even though I plugged in nicely and everything connected nicely, nothing came of it. And then I had another one and it didn't work as well. So eventually I had to just buy the one that comes with the camera, and I bought three of them. And two of them ended up breaking or stopped working or got really crackly. And then the third one got me there. So it took me three, and they're about $20-something each to get through South America. But with cameras, if you want to do voiceover, you can use the GoPro and get a bit of a setup going yourself. It's a little bit complicated. We're with this Drift Ghost, and they've got the new version coming out soon. They've been talking about it for about 3 or 4 months now. However, you know, with these sort of videos, I'm interested in frame rates and quality of the video. You know, 4K won't make me jump to a new camera. What will make me go is, you know, massive frame rates of 1080 or 1920, which is being shot in, getting really good frame rates up, so that just improves the quality. Plus, it means you can do a lot more in post with it. So, into the technical aspect side of things, is it's a great camera, the Drift. The customer support for a small company is pretty poor. Even though I was chatting for a while, the girl who was on Instagram with Drift was fantastic, but as soon as I got in contact with the company, they just weren't interested in helping. Like, they wouldn't ship they said they can't ship to Colombia, even though I was going to be there for 3 weeks in one city. They said they can't ship, so I got it shipped to a friend here in Miami, and then they shipped it to me. I bought them through Amazon, and they got shipped with a few days to Miami Beach, and then from Miami Beach got shipped to, so I could do it. I mean, if they wanted to do it, they could very easily just package it up and put it into a envelope and send it to the address that I gave them in Colombia, but they just couldn't be bothered. And that's pretty disappointing from a company that really wants to be, you know, has to compete with the big boys. If you don't have customer service as a small company, you're gonna fail, and that, you know, that was a little bit disappointing from them. But I really like the camera. The remote control on the arm will go for about 6 hours, so much better than a GoPro. You know, you can get buy two remotes, which I did. I ended up losing one somewhere, I don't know where. And I also had three batteries. I had four to begin with, then three, and then I finished with two. Two of them one of them got a little bit damp and just expanded and couldn't get in and out of the camera. And the other one just went after a while. So I ended up finishing with two. So the batteries will last you a pretty good solid 4 hours you'll get out of a battery. Towards the end of the trip, I was getting about 3 hours out of the batteries. But that's fine. I mean, you know, if you've got three batteries, that's going to get you through most days. I would suggest, if you're going to get the Ghost, get four or five batteries as a backup, and get a wall charger for it as well, because If you want to, then you can charge with the USB cable. You can charge it directly using USB, but you can also plug one into a wall, which I used to do. I used to get to the hotel, plug it into a wall, and then put all the ones that needed charging on top of it, and then switch them out and put them in my tank bag once they were done. And basically, that's the only issue, is that batteries take a long time to charge, probably two to three hours for each battery to charge, so nearly charging at the same rate. That's using the wall mount one, which is a third party device, and also the USB cable. But the good quality videos, you plug it into your computer and you can, I don't think their app is useless. I never even used it. I tried to use it a couple of times and I just thought, what's the point? So I just plugged into a computer and downloaded. So one thing you can do with your videos after each day is to actually create a folder and call them like ride days, so that all the photos and all the videos for each ride day you do is put into that folder, and then you can use them later on and upload them later on and do what you want with them. So I did that. So basically I used the Revver app to track my whole ride, so I can actually post it. You can see them on my website, all the rides, the elevation, the time it took, the top speed, the average speed. What I did with the average speed is always low, because even when I stopped, I kept the app running, because otherwise sometimes I just forget to press to start again. And if there's one thing Revver can do, and they're always improving it, but if there's one thing they can do, it would be great if they could actually have it so it automatically recognized when you stopped, because it does, it's hitting the satellites all the time, so it should know when you're stationary, and then just create a stop point if you're stationary for more than a minute or two, 5 minutes or whatever, and then continue again when you start riding. That would be a great little feature for them to have, instead of having to pause it then start it again, which I did a couple of times and forgot to start it. And then so you'll see some rides that I've done on the Revver where it looks like I've stopped and then just taken the bike 50 kilometers or 100 kilometers by an airplane and then started again. So yeah, but anyway, to finish this off, I had the second day's ride was getting to Laguna Beach and crossing quite a few bridges towards the end of the ride, and it was really nice to get a bit of a sea breeze because it was freaking hot, and I was still sore, but you know, a few more days I knew that all that sort of pain will go. So yeah, so if you've got any questions or comments, put them below, and I'll get back to you very quickly. Thank you.